So it's important to understand the overarching goals that your security controls need to be in service of. Otherwise, we're just kind of wasting time and resources on a control, and that control is not going to have a lot of impact on the security of the business. So in so doing, we want to take advantage of strategies. All right, we're going to achieve these goals through different operational security strategies, which is what we're going to look at in this topic. The process of security automation has the ability to drastically increase the efficiency of different kinds of security-related tasks. Manual processes are indispensable, but they can take some time and they are prone to errors. Automating those tasks will make what are otherwise tedious, time-consuming tasks go faster and make it less likely for you to have issues, okay? One example would be the validation of a configuration. That requires a security professional to go through an entire system and compare each individual configuration to an accepted baseline. If you delegate that task to an automated tool, it's going to save you time, but it also may produce more accurate results because the automated task is able to do that in a more efficient way and a more precise way. Another example would be continuous monitoring. Constantly scanning an environment for threats, vulnerabilities, other areas of risk. Automating that process is far more efficient than relying on individuals to detect issues. And you can also automate the course of action that'll be taken once it is found. So the IPS is configured, for instance, to automatically block traffic that is deemed sufficient. Automation may happen at a certain level just through a customization of a particular tool. However, you can also enhance automation through scripting. And so scripting provides the steps that are going to be taken in an automatic fashion. Templates can also provide baselines for automated deployment. Master images can be created and deployed automatically, and that's commonly done when dealing with virtual machines. Scalability is a concept or a goal, a property by which the computer environment is able to gracefully fulfill its ever-increasing resource needs. As the business grows, so does the workload, and a scalable environment is one that's able to adjust to those kinds of changes without disruption. These changes can come from different areas: increased bandwidth needs, memory needs, storage space, increased number of identities in the identity management system, and more. And the scalable environment will add more resources and strengthen existing resources. You have two options: scale up or scale out. Scale up allows me to add more resources in or to that system, okay, so increase the power of those resources. Scale out allows me to add more systems and in so doing more resources, all right? So it just kind of depends. Scaling out will be usually the one that is used just because it's a little bit easier to implement. This scaling out can happen automatically. When we get into cloud computing, one of the common terms that's used is elasticity. Technically, elasticity would apply to virtualization setups as well, just standard virtualization where the cloud is not used. But in the cloud, because of the dynamic provisioning and the pay-as-you-go model, they utilize the term elasticity. It's very, very closely tied to scalability, only it's not just to increase, but also to decrease. So it's elastic, like the elastic waistband on your pants that you need on Thanksgiving, right? The resource demands will fluctuate in the short term. They'll account for increases in demand, but they'll also account for decreases in demand. This streamlines operations and saves money. And if you think about this from a cloud perspective, it makes sense. It's a common selling point for cloud services. I don't need resources running at full power 24/7. When the demand is low, the resource should power down. When the demand is high and increases, the resource should power up again. So it gives us cost effectiveness. I wouldn't want to increase to 8 VMs supporting an application and all of a sudden I only need one. You know, so it's going to expand and contract on an as-needed basis. Another common term is redundancy. This is the property by which a computing environment keeps one or more sets of additional resources in addition to the primary set of resources. So the system maintains an extra copy of a resource. The copy can be full or partial, but the redundancy corrects issues due to compromise, also due to failure. The resource can be reconstructed, an exact copy, or specific errors can be corrected, as in a partial copy. The resource set continues to provide services without a disruption and loss. The whole idea with redundancy is to identify and eliminate single points of failure. So if in the case of a database, for instance, we have a copy of that database, it's a full copy, it's kept up to date by sending updates to it on, you know, in a real-time basis. If the current database fails, then I can restore or I can activate the redundant copy of the database. If an individual item in the current database is deleted, if I get to the backup database before that item is deleted, I can recover it. And that's simply one example. Redundancy is built into our systems all the time and has a great deal to do with the availability of the system. Redundancy is used to provide fault tolerance. Fault tolerance really speaks to the system's ability to withstand failure. Your ability to withstand failure is directly related to the redundancy built into the system. So, but fault tolerance is going to, you know, identify, eliminate single points of failure. It relates to uptimes. So measures include compensating for power outages and spikes, disk and data storage corruption or loss, network component failure, inefficiency, loss of a internet connection, loss of WAN connections, and more. And so the way to provide this fault tolerance is to build in redundancy so that if one component fails, the redundant copy can maintain functionality. In reality, fault tolerance and redundancy are built in various areas, but one of the most common areas for us to think about is the disk. We have an acronym or a specification identified by acronym, Redundant Array of Independent Disk, or RAID. And this is a spec that supports redundancy and fault tolerance for multiple device storage systems. The idea is if you have volumes that are pointed to a single physical drive, then should that single physical drive fail, that it will render the volume inaccessible. If, however, I have multiple physical drives that make up a logical volume, then one or more of those devices could fail and the data is still accessible. RAID is most commonly implemented through hardware implementations. There are several different RAID levels. RAID 0 is just striping and splitting data. It actually doesn't add any redundancy. It's called striping. RAID 1 is a mirror. Okay, that's actually what we're seeing here. And in a mirror situation, you have an exact duplicate. Data is simultaneously replicated from one storage to device to another. Now, this will decrease write performance, but it increases redundancy. RAID 5, we're splitting across three or more disks, and we're adding parity information. Okay, so as you write information on one disk, parity information is written on the others. So if you lose a drive, you have the ability to use that parity information to restore the data from the failed drive. Another property within a computing environment is non-persistence. This is the property by which data is discarded once it's finished with its assigned task or hardware is discarded. So a VDI example, the virtual desktop infrastructure, for instance, in standard persistent mode, the user can customize their virtual desktop to their liking. And when they log out, those changes are going to be kept. In non-persistent mode, the changes are lost. When they log out, all configurations that the user made during that session would be lost. Non-persistence is used because it enhances security operations and it allows you to have tighter control over the virtual environments. If you give it enough time, a persistent VM will ultimately always deviate from the security guideline, and that then becomes a vulnerability. Non-persistent VMs routinely fall back into that security state. So they use master images and snapshots to support non-persistence. A snapshot captures a VM state at a particular point in time. It's also referred to as a checkpoint, and then you can always revert back to that checkpoint. This is just the baseline. You may not need to go all the way back to the master image every time because of the checkpoint utilization. So this is a concept that is used often in those virtual desktop infrastructures in order to maintain security. Another property that we deal with is high availability. This is the property that expresses how closely systems approach the goal of providing 100% data availability with sufficient performance. It is measured in nines, and it relates to unscheduled downtime or uptime, and the relationship of the two, right? So we could say we want a, you know, four nines, 99.99% uptime. That is less than an hour of unscheduled downtime a year. Uptime of 99.9 is less than 9 hours of downtime in a year. So in any of these cases, that's a lot of uptime. And what it means is we need to implement redundancy. Okay, we've got a distributive allocation of software. We use clustering, which gives us automatic failover. We use load balancing, which is a different kind of clustering. And we implement redundancy just about everywhere we find a single point of failure, because in so doing, the loss of that individual component would not render the system as failed. Instead, it would allow me to continue utilizing that system. Now, the process of deploying and provisioning systems and resources and software is accomplished through different types of environments. We see some of those environments here. The environments ensure that the service is being deployed and is thoroughly checked for compliance with security policies, while making sure that it's useful as well. So development environments are used to develop in-house software. It's where it's being designed and actively programmed. These environments are likely going to support more than just one development need, and they may not be necessary for certain resource types. It's going to support whatever method the organization is adhering to. Testing environments ensures that all assets meet compliance requirements. These are isolated sandbox environments that can be used for software testing. TCB, trusted computing base environments, can be used to measure the integrity of the testing process. We're trying to verify files that haven't been tampered with by comparing hash values, legitimate values before execution, etc. Staging environments. This is where staging is set up in an environment to facilitate testing. Like, for example, the secure baseline master image is used to revert test VMs back to an original state. The staging environment simulates the production environment. We're trying to get as realistic results as possible. And then production environment is when the asset is pushed into production after testing concludes. The asset is deployed to end users, or maybe it's just put in a running state, but in any case, the environment is live. And so you need to provide security assurances like high availability. All right, so those are some security strategies, some properties that we try to adhere to. Just a quick refresh on those. We need to make sure that we are supplementing manual security processes with automated processes as much as possible, as that will increase efficiency and accuracy. We want to try to ensure that the systems are always scalable so they can meet long-term increases in demand. In some cases, we may want to use elasticity so that we can expand and collapse to meet those demands. We want to always make sure we have redundancy and fault tolerance that provides high availability for us. One consideration is RAID, but in reality, we look at the organization, we identify any points of failure, any single points of failure, and then I construct redundancy in order to address those single points of failure. Okay? And then, we talked about non-persistence in virtual environments as enhancing security, and we can also consider incorporating various deployment environments to facilitate our particular needs. So all of those are going to be very important guidelines for implementing security strategies.